Good evening, everyone. My name is Nisha Tandon, and I'm reaching you from Dubai. A warm welcome to Jashn-e-Azadi, organized by Asian Literary Society on the eve of its India's 75th Independence Day. What better topic to discuss today than freedom from disability? Before anything can be done to eradicate disability, it is essential to change the mindset of the society and get it instrumental in the upliftment of people with special needs, most importantly, just by acceptance. There are people working in this field and it has not been an easy ride for them. To get support for this cause is a Herculean task. Today, we wish to laud two such personalities who are working relentlessly and selflessly to give a better life to the people with special needs and helping them to get freedom from disability to some extent. I would like to introduce and welcome our distinguished guests for the evening, who will give us an insight into whether truly there is any freedom from disability, and if yes, how. It is my honor to welcome Mrs. Shraddha, mother of an specially abled child and the founder of Madhuram Charitable Trust. Ms. Shraddha vowed to do something for the benefit of the marginalized, specially gifted and physically challenged people and children. Founded in the year 2019, in a span of 2 years, the NGO has made a noticeable difference in the lives of more than 100 special kids by providing various therapies, hearing aids, crutches, speech therapists, and Botox surgeries. Ms. Shraddha is also a board member of Special Olympics Gujarat, committed to bringing about a drastic change in the outlook of people and making them aware of the importance of prosthetic legs. Madhuram Charitable Trust has organized Stepathon, a small step towards achieving the goal of giving people a second chance. A very, very warm welcome to you, Ms. Shraddha.
Thank you very much, Nisha, for the very elaborate introduction. It's absolutely unnecessary. I like the first part, and I like to be addressed as the mother of a special child because that's the most important part of my life. Thank you so much.
Such a wonderful thing to say. I think we all take pride in that. I mean, when people are shying away from being, known for your children, I think we have stepped up and, being very, very proud parents.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much. It's a real pleasure to have you, and we look forward to speaking to you.
Pleasure is all.
Thank you, Shraddha. Our second guest today is Dr. Mona Patel, who is a pediatric rehab specialist and founder of Spursh Pediatric Rehabilitation Clinic. She has 19 years of clinical experience and has served as teaching faculty in many webinars, workshops, and conferences. According to her, water has a natural healing property, and that's why she ventured into aquatic therapy for children with special needs. After completing her graduation, Dr. Mona began her career with Kalara CP Center, an NGO run by National Security for Equal Opportunities for the Handicapped, until 2006, when she laid the foundation of Spursh as a neurodevelopmental therapy clinic and continued to pursue short courses and workshops regarding pediatric rehabilitation on different subjects to hone her skills. It is our pleasure to have you with us today, Dr. Mona. A very, very warm welcome.
Thank you. That was again a very detailed and elaborated introduction. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you so much. And we also welcome Zeba, who is relentlessly working towards this cause along with ALS. Thank you so much, Zeba, for being here today.
Thank you so much, Isha. And one more point I want to add about Dr. Mona Patel. In the span of last 19 years, she has touched more than 10,000 lives of individuals with special needs. And that in itself is a huge achievement for her.
We congratulate you on that, Dr. Mona. And we look forward to getting such more information about this, because we plan to take this venture of Asian Literary Society ahead. So, we'd like your support always for this.
Thank you. She is there. Both of them are there for us.
Thank you so much. So there'll be a few questions that I'll be asking you. You know, the time is not too, we've got limited time of around 30 to 35 minutes, and there's so much to know from you. So I'll start from with Ms. Shraddha. Ms. Shraddha, do you think there is a scope of freedom from, like the theme today is freedom from disability, but do you actually think there is a freedom of from disability at all? And how does your charitable trust step up to help us?
Okay, so this is two questions from mine. First of all, now she's asking freedom from disability. I always feel that an early intervention does lead to a freedom from disability. Most of the cases that come to me in the NGO are further stalled because of delay of the parents. Correct. Or because parents not accepting that the child is, you know, special in a certain way. And because they don't want to accept that, it actually harms the child more because the treatment is delayed. But having said that, I think the word freedom from disability is, I think all of us are disabled in some way or the other.
Like exactly my thoughts.
मैंने hearing aid लगाया हुआ है. So I think we all have some or the other form of disability. Na some kuch nahi to mental disability in some way. We might get angry soon, or we might get very very emotional. So a true freedom from disability lies in the mind. That's what.
This is such a beautiful thought, Ms. Shraddha, because I think I resonate with your thoughts a lot. कि मुझे भी लगता है कि ये जो हमारे अंदर जो mental blockages हैं, they are the biggest disability. So they are, you know, preventing us from taking a step forward and you know, enhancing our lives. So Dr. Mona, what are your thoughts on the same? For you, what does like the what does the theme mean to you?
Yeah, I completely agree. I think he said it so appropriately that it is in the mindset. Whenever a parent comes to me and they will ask that when will my child become normal, you know, whenever they come first, there is a strong struggle in terms of something irreversible has happened to us, whether my child will become normal or not. You know, it's a struggle when the news comes to you and when you get to know that the most precious thing in life, your own child has some issues with him. So it takes time, but I agree that there's nothing like normal. Every person has their own share of difficulties. So
yes.
The real problem lies in the mindset. If we accept, if we acknowledge, and then if we prepare and get better equipped and aware about it, then we can handle it and we can find the strength in from anybody. You know? So the real freedom from disability really lies in the mindset, as well as getting more aware, informed, and skilled for that to really address it correctly and in time.
Absolutely.
Intervention.
So, frankly, yeah, true.
Right. What happens is that with that acceptance difficulty, as a professional, what we see is we lose on a precious time where we can really make good change. You know, the medical terminology, we call it the golden hour or the golden time. Right.
Yes.
So if we create better awareness, if we have less taboo around it, then it could be easier for parents to accept. So creating more awareness about it is something which is strongly needed, so that parents can understand easily and can accept it in time, so that they don't lose out on time and they get to know it in more appropriately, and then they can start working on it appropriately. So yeah, mindset as well as preparation.
So true. I think more than the child, it is the parent and the people, you know, the society around. They need to come out of this disability. They need the freedom from disability. Because, you know, when my daughter was born, she's going to turn 18 now. So in the OT, in the operation theater, I knew that she has Down syndrome, though they had not diagnosed Down syndrome. So for me, those 2 days till the reports came were very difficult. But once it came to me and I had no choice but to accept, you know, so for me, everything starts from acceptance. So whenever I speak to parents or I speak on forums, I say acceptance is a key to success for the children.
Correct. Yes.
So I'm sure all of you will agree with that.
Yeah. Most definitely. That's the most important thing. I mean, we see such diverse parents and every family has their own struggle. But
yes,
I usually see the families which really come out wisely and nicely are the ones who accept it early and start preparing themselves for it and start working towards it. I think movement really mobilizes your brain. So, you know, accepting and then working towards it is the thing which is really required.
So true, so true. So, Ms. Shraddha, I have a question for you here. So, what is the success rate in, you know, and ease of use of the prosthetic legs? Like we talked about Stepathon. So, a little insight into what this Stepathon is, so that our audience know there's something like this exists, you know, and they could avail of these facilities in case somebody needs it.
Yes. So we all have heard of marathon. We all have heard of cyclothons, triathlons. Yes. So what I am empowering people here, people who don't have one leg or two legs, maybe they've lost it in an accident or polio or surgery or amputated for diabetes, so many other reasons. So what my thing is that that person should be able to take one step. That's why I call it Stepathon. So now the whole idea behind Stepathon was to provide the best quality legs that are available in the world, not only in the country. I did my research and I figured out that was coming from Germany. So we have imported 100 legs from Germany. These are very high-end prosthetic legs. These are not very. These are not the plastic legs that are available. They are AI inbuilt. They are coated. And we have very good high level of sustainability and strength. The cost of each leg is around 1 lakh. It goes 20,000 up or down, depending whether the amputee has a knee or doesn't have a knee, and above thigh, below thigh, or just the foot. The whole idea behind Stepathon was last year I was with Vijay Bhai and he told me, "Ki Shraddha, ye itne mehenge legs that you have given, you know, what is the purpose? I mean, you getting these legs, like cheap legs, you know, for 15,000, 20,000. The whole purpose behind Stepathon is that whatever the rich use, the poor should also get that, at least in terms of medical facility. I'm not talking about everyone should have a role, that everyone should have a big house. But as far as the legs are concerned, the richest and the poorest of the country should have the same. So we don't want to compromise on quality just because somebody is poor. So the whole purpose of Madhuram and the whole purpose of Stepathon is to provide the best to the person who can afford the least. So if you have anyone who requires the leg and who cannot afford it, then please get in touch. We still have 30 more legs to give and we are full of funds and we are waiting for genuine people who are in genuine financial trouble. And if you know someone, please tell them to get in touch.
Such a wonderful deed you are doing, Ms. Shraddha. Really, really appreciate this. And in fact, we'd like to, spread this news as much and this, cause of yours as much possible so that, anybody who is needy, not misusing the facilities that are provided. And we'd like to, and I'll request our, founder is here, Manoj, to please take this forward and help as many people as we can. So Zeba, we are really, really glad that we have somebody, who's got such a big heart and who's trying to help the society. Thank you so much, Zeba, for bringing
up. Shraddha ji, she is a wonderful woman. I know her since last, I think, 2 or 3 years. And whenever she tells me, Zeba, I need some help in organizing some event, please volunteer for us. But I am always ready for her. And I know she is always ready for others who need her.
Really appreciate.
There can be a difference in what I wear and what my maid is wearing. There could be a difference between what I eat and what my maid is eating. But according to what Shraddha said, there should not be a difference in the medical facility. Both me and my maid, they should get the same medical facility. And when this disability sector comes, I have seen patients who doesn't have the food to eat. Now they are getting the best of the best therapy in the private clinics of Ahmedabad only because of Madhuram and Shraddha ji. She is sponsoring those therapies for them.
God bless you. God bless you.
Thank you so much.
अदरवाइज वो लोग तो गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल्स के ही और वैसे वो धक्के ही खाते रह जाते यहाँ वहाँ
नहीं
आने जर्नी इन लास्ट 20 years, बट द वे श्रद्धा has a golden heart and the effort she has put in Madura and the amount of fun she has created and the amount of people's life she has touched. So amazing. I really respect her for that.
Thank you so much.
We'll have to increase the screen capacity because I'm very much phone. You guys are really don't appreciate so much. I'm just doing my job. That's all right.
Thank you so much, and we'll take it forward. And the audience who has joined are, you know, leaving behind wonderful words. I would not be able to read them all, but definitely once the session is through, please go through those comments and compliments. I think they feel for this cause. So thank you so much. So my next question to you would be, Dr. Mona, how does aqua therapy help the people with special needs, and can you share your strategies you adopt to deal with them as they have different needs? You know, each child has a different need. So how do you get to, which therapy would be needed for which child?
Yeah, so first of all, I want to clear this question among parents that aquatic therapy is different from swimming. So see, water has a magical property. The fluid mechanics is so amazing. You can work with a real good thought, and you can create so much out of water. It's a completely different medium, and it is very helpful. One, because it has a very rich sensory motor properties. I'll try to simplify it a bit. So, for example, if you see any person or any child with physical disability, one of the things which they struggle is movement against gravity. And when you work in the water, you don't have gravity there. You have buoyancy, which makes you lightweight. So one of the best help water gives you is that it makes you weight free. So you can easily move.
Yes.
So the moment you take any kid with a physical disability, his motivation to move and his ability and participation increases. Right? And what happens when we do aquatic therapy, we have developed a very structured protocol, right, with the science behind it, where we use the fluid mechanics, the principle, the physical property of the water, we use it intelligently to enhance and support their development. So it supports a compromised motor system in a very positive way. If you go again to any child who has autism or ADHD, then what happens, when you go in the water, you get a whole body tactile cues. You have your whole body has an information. So what happens with that is that you are more aware of your body, and that's why your mind and body connection strengthens. And so you can have so many goals and work on it. Like, you can increase the motivation, you can increase the attention, you can develop a better self-regulation. For example, I just share this thing that I had a kid with autism, a 4-year-old, had not slept since 3 days, and I did the first aquatic session, and he had not slept for 3 days, day and night, and I did the first aquatic session, and after that he slept for an hour in a day time. So it is such a positive aura on us as a normal human. I mean, also it supports people who have challenges. And if you work therapeutically and intelligently and use the property of water very specifically, then you can achieve not many goals out of it. So water, aquatic therapy definitely has edge if you use combination with the land-based therapy.
Wonderful, wonderful, excellent information. Thank you so much, Dr. Mona. Because my daughter, she's been attending aquatic therapy for just because I want her to be engaged. So she's been attending for last 3-4 years, and she thoroughly enjoys them. She knows swimming as well, but she enjoys those because there are a lot of sessions. They're doing aerobics inside the water. So I think it has a lot of healing to the body. It gives a lot of healing.
Yeah, So I'll just tell you, there are a lot of research also where they say that aquatic therapy, especially, it really helps with attention engagement and social, improves the social interaction in kids with ASD. And it really helps you to increase the attention span with the kids with ADHD. So when even there is an effect, positive effect on the executive function, cognition also. So now I think more and more professionals very constructively practicing aquatic therapy throughout the world, and a lot of research and data coming out, which is so encouraging. So I would really recommend people to use aquatic therapy again early in their life, their kids' life, to really get the best benefit out of it.
But tell me something, Dr. Mona, because you know everything costs money. So how are you able to convince the parents that this is a need of the hour, your child needs this, and how forthcoming are the parents? You know, parents would, I think, step back because of probably the finances involved. So how are you able to convince?
So as I said, that every family has their own struggle. I have a very child-centric attitude when I work with families, right? When I met them, I also understand their socio-economic status also. And we sit together, yes. We discuss that, and then we work around that so that they get it. The idea here is to help them in whatever capacity is possible. And then we do strategies, especially with the younger babies. I do create some small vessel based therapy at home also, and they are able to get that also. For example, for a lot of infants, they use very small pools inside home where they just put them to increase their participation in home, right? And so we are really building up the resource. We are working on more and more strategies to make it available to every strata of society, because it is very helpful.
That's wonderful. I think it's a good thing. So doing it at home, I think, you know, it helps, because then the parents gain that confidence that it is helping my child. And then, you know, they may just... So, Shraddha, what do you have to say about this? Do you also face resistance from parents? And how do you overcome that? Yes, you are.
Okay. So, in my case, I would say my daughter has only started working because of Mona and Tejas Bhai and their aquatherapy. So, full credits to them. And I have seen how much aquatherapy has helped her. Many times, me and Mona have had a lot of arguments because, you know, it was cold and I used to say, because parents, as a parent, you have an apprehension, you know, all the time, out of water, she might catch a cold, she might get fever, be dengue chal raha hai, COVID chal raha hai, all these things. But then we always used to have an argument, and then obviously they used to win, and for the better, because I feel that she has benefited a lot because of aquatherapy. Somehow, I don't know, I only understand buoyancy. I never get into the technical parts of what they are doing to her, because I know they are doing the best. But if your child has cerebral palsy or any kind of spastic muscles or anything which is tight, as far as my knowledge goes, you need to go for aquatherapy.
That's wonderful. So as parents, we need to...
I think if you see that, I see in Ahmedabad, I have seen a lot of kids on autism spectrum disorder. I've seen them benefiting in their self-regulation and their activity level and their attention level simply by practicing the swimming session with a regular coach.
Right.
If they get the help of a mindful therapist and a very enriched medium like water, if they get combined and if we work on that, then definitely the result will be plus.
I think water does affect you in some way, because I remember even when we were young and, you know, when you play sports and you come back home, and my mom used to say, okay, you know, just put a pinch of salt in the bucket and just take a bath. And, you know, even the Turkey hammam, they are famous for, you know, relieving stress. So I feel yes, water even for us, I think a good tub bath always works. So definitely it would have more effect on the kids who are mentally or physically disturbed or challenged.
So here we have a very important question from Mr. Anil Kumar Srivastava. He says, what are the basic symptoms in which patient requires aqua therapy? So do you have any diagnosis you do, or you study the case study, you do case study and then decide?
Yeah, so I'll tell you, it will help to any child from a special need community. Okay, whether the child has a diagnosis of spinal muscle atrophy or cerebral palsy or autism or ADHD, you know, or has the issues with motor planning, like they have a issue with understanding their body and having advanced level gross motor system problems, like they don't have the ability to plan, to learn to catch or learn to ride cycle. Like these are very subtle issues. You know, parents come to know around 4, 5, 6 years of age, or they cannot button. So even with those kids also, what happens when you work in two media, one is water and one is air. So air has gravity and water has a buoyancy, right? When you work in two different mediums, one of the greatest advantage, which I think every parent needs to understand, or for that matter, every therapist needs to understand, is when you work in two different mediums and you try to manage your body, your brain's problem solving capacity increases. And that will help you with the generalization skill. Like many of our kids, when they learn one task, they do it in one scenario. But when you put them in different conditions, right, they will not be able to generalize it so well. So when you work in two mediums, somewhere your brain's ability problem solve is going to increase, and their capacity to learn is going to increase. So this is what something I'll say. For example, if somebody is very new to water and first time enters the pool, right, they go back to the primitive self, they'll be all scared, you know, they'll move like a small baby, and then they gradually give up. So similar, because it's a new medium, your brain needs to understand it. So when you put the thing in two different mediums and work on it, it's definitely going to support child's brain and the learning capacity. I think every parent needs to understand this particular thing.
Thank you so much.
It will help any adult or any child with difficulties. Because it also
helps.
For example, if I am really tired, my system is exhausted, and if I take a good swimming session, I take a swimming session, I will definitely feel calmer, better, and more regular. Right? It helps a neurotypical brain also, which has a good learning capacity to regulate well. So if you use it intelligently with kids who have challenges because of the any kind of brain-related issues, then definitely it is going to support.
So thank you so much for answering that, Dr. Mona, and Mr. Anil is quite happy about the answer, and we're quite satisfied. So thank you for answering that. Shraddha, we have another question for you. See, now you are, I think, limited to Ahmedabad itself, right? Your charitable trust. So how do you plan to in future to reach out and support people with special needs pan India? So do you have any such plans in your mind?
Yeah, so we are not only limited to Ahmedabad, we are limited to Gujarat.
Okay.
And of course, I have very big dreams. I'm a big dreamer. And I want, you know, it should reach not only India, but all across the globe. Why not? We've gotten our tax exemption only 1.5 years ago. So we've just finished a little up to 100 cases in this time. But expansion has to happen mindfully. It has to happen slowly, and it has to happen under my hawk eyes, okay? Because I cannot leave sight of what's happening and just expand for the sake of expansion. Because what happens in an NGO is that misuse is very easy. It's very common. Corruption is very common. So that is something which I plan to do, but it has to be done slowly. Once we stabilize a bit, and once I find someone whom I can trust, maybe as an employee or as a partner. So it happens very slowly. So I believe that the quality is more important than quantity. So right now I am fully in good that, but I have plans. So I have big plans. So yes, why not?
India and we will definitely expand.
But mine.
Such a wonderful thought on that. We also wish you all the best for this. Thank you so much. And what is your association with Special Olympics? So can you just share with the audience even that? Because Olympics is the topic of the hour, you know. Everybody is discussing since we've got so many medals home. So, you know, everybody's focus has shifted from, you know, maybe local and national games to Olympics now. So they're aiming higher.
Yes. Special Olympics and Para Olympics are different. Just to clarify, Para Olympics is something which a physically disabled person can also run and also contest in. Special Olympics is something, it is a federal body, it is a national body recognized by the government. It was started by the Mr. John F. Kennedy in the US, and now it is branching everywhere. And then eventually, it was so popular that the government of India decided to make it a federal organization. Now, why I am there is for two reasons. Like Mona is doing aqua therapy, I think sports is very important in the life of a person. It can be anything. So, swimming is definitely one. A simple game of basketball, a simple game of cricket. A special child might not understand cricket, but might understand the bag.
Correct.
So, sports is very important. And, you know, so when I have a few people who I am helping, and Special Olympics is one place that children get a lot of exposure in sports. So I thought if I could club both the two, then it would benefit. So that's how I am there. And I have just very recently joined. It's not even been 6 months, and we are planning to do some good work together. But the one thing that really strikes me about Special Olympics is I also met few winners. I met a person with Brian. I met a special kid who has, you know, won the India trophy. We have not done the internationals of now. We have not won in anything. Is that the simplicity of the special kids? You know, they have won on such a big level, but they don't know. They don't care. For them, same before winning, they were same after winning. So, you know, that is the simplicity of the special kid. And it is the innocence that we love about the special child. They are not into winning. They are just enjoying. They are running because they enjoy the run. They are not running about for winning. They don't care about losing. And this is something which we need to learn from the special kid. It's to enjoy every moment. And just to be free from fear of failure. You know? And the arrogance of winning. Both. So I think
true, absolutely.
Yes,
very true.
No, here I'd like to share, you know, my daughter and her best friend were running a race. So both are Down syndrome, closest friends in Mumbai. She was studying in Mumbai at that time. And they had a relay race. So you're supposed to wear some, you know, winter wear and then run. So my daughter Anushka, she reached the last and she was supposed to run. You know, she stopped in the middle. She waited for her friend to catch up. She ensured that she has worn the sweater also and held her hand and ran, you know. So that spirit was so, that moment I think will live with me forever. So it is a spirit of, you know, participation. It is not about winning.
Yeah, participation.
And any parents here or anyone here who would like to enroll their special kid for Special Olympics, please get in touch.
So I'd like to, you know, people spread this message and this whatever the session we are having as much possible and let it reach the right people. You know, it should not die down. We've started something with the good cause. Let us take it forward. So, you know, we'll request all our members on Asian Literary Society to share it in their groups. So at least, you know, anybody who needs it or who wants to do it and doesn't have the means can reach out to you.
Absolutely.
So, Mona, here I'd like to ask you another question. As parents, now I have a special daughter. As parents, there are many people who would be having special children or would be, you know, friends having special children. What should the attitude of the parents be? You know, sometimes we live in denial. Okay. So, acceptance we've spoken about. Apart from that, what should we do to ensure, you know, that our children are making the right progress.
One of the things which I have lived and experienced is, so as a professional, one thing which is a part of my personality is continuous updating myself. You know, the more you know, the better you can get. Right? So I think the same advice I'll give to a parent, that the more you are aware about what is there and what is available around, and then making that happen for your child. You know, what happens, what I've seen is how they look at time is that, okay, my child is, okay, here I am with my kid, and he doesn't have this, 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 this. Okay, when he will get married, when he will go to school, okay, will he have normal life? So, on day one, this is absolutely fine. But if you yes. are the journey, and if you see that I, as a professor, trying to work on every thing and appreciate every small change the child makes or every small effort child makes and get success out of it, you also have to be on the field with me. Right? I have realized over the span of 20 years that the families where I make changes with the kids are the families where parents are my partners in the mission.
Oh, wonderful.
Right? So, if the parent understands it well, and if we become partner and go on the mission together, right, then, see, alone parent doing everything doesn't take you everywhere. Alone therapist cannot take things, you know, that is also a hard learned thing, that you cannot take everything, right? So making a team, it is a transdisciplinary, right? You require a lot of people, a lot of mindful people, professional and a parent both.
Yeah,
really learning it, really understanding it, and making things, you know, one of the things which I feel that really putting more effort in helping your child get more success. If I tell you, there is one thing which I feel, if something is very difficult for you for too long, you leave it. This is the general human psychology. It's true for
parents also.
Yeah, it's a true, yes. true for any rehab professional also, and it's for a special kid also. Right? So, really provide as a team of a parent and a professional, providing the right kind of challenge and making your child have more success in what they do. Right? And providing, empowering your child with the right mindset toward what they have. Because how you see your child is standing like that and the world like that. So, really putting those things really early in their life and really understanding and working towards it and being present to it completely. I think that is something I would advise to each and every parent. I think if you are, it always goes like up and down. You know, you have your share of up and down. But if you remain mindful and remember these things and be with your child and be happy with what you have at hand and then build upon it, I think you will always go plus plus. In the long run. So that is what I will.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Dr. Mona. Though we would like this session to go on and on, but I think we'll ask Shraddha to just address one question that we have. It's important. I think both of you could answer that. Archana Tandon wants to know, is there a common government website where one can register to get continuously updated on our issues and for such kids?
It's a government website. Which is
yes, so anything where you know we could access information on this with for special children, whatever, in case they need any therapies or they need any status updates. Is there any government website where you know you are aware of?
So, Go ahead. Yeah, so there's one thing I think on government website you can get a lot of information about the kind of financial support you can get through different schemes or the benefit as a special kid you get. So definitely there are websites for that, like there's a scheme Niramaya with the National Trust which helps if you register under it, you get some kind of financial help under different segments. So that's kind of an insurance for a special kid. There are a lot of benefits for special kids in terms of quota or in terms of benefits they can get writer, they can go through an iOS. There are a lot of other things. But in terms of the real update which is happening around the globe and to match along with it, I feel we really lack there and we need to work a lot.
Yes.
The combination is so long. You know, because what happens, that's what is my struggle also as a professional. The kind of exposure, the clinical exposure, what I have as a very, very, I would say very, very very aggressive therapist. So I really believe in learning and I keep effort, right? And many times what I see is that the kind of clinical exposure or the kind of ability we have is amazing. But the resources, when it comes to resources, like finding the basic resources. For example, if I say that to find a good standard or the sitting chair or the good sleeping motion care system or providing a good aid which supports their body like headphones or something, it's also so difficult. You don't get even the good.
Or if you thank you so much.
Sorry. Yeah.
No. So any last words from you, Shraddha, on this? No, I know this topic is such it and it touches so many lives. And we have all seen in the society somebody or the other. It may not be in your own homes, you know, and you would want to step up and, you know, help them. So you are doing a wonderful work at this, creating awareness as well. And we would like to partner with you in this whenever we can help, however way we can help. So thank you so much for this. And Shraddha, was some last words from you before we wind up the session?
See, there is no particular government website which will give you updates on anything. However, government has a scheme where it is providing financial help. It is providing some care structures. It's also doing cochlear implants are for free. All this information you will get at Civil. If you go to Civil and inquire at Civil Hospital, they will give you the information. But they will never have the updated news. So what are you looking for? Financial help or updated news? Updated news, as far as I see, it is always good approach a senior doctor who is specialized in this. And please, I request parents, do not Google. Please do not.
It is the worst thing one can do.
That symptom, this, what is the thing? So there are a lot of, Google is an algorithm. Please understand, Google is not a Bible. It's not a code, it's an algorithm. It will give you search as per what you are searching. So please do not Google symptoms of your kids. If you ask me to give one important advice, this would be it. Do not Google symptoms.
Thank you so much. Means a lot. No Googling. So I think that word should go very strongly across to the audience and especially the children because they are so dependent on Google right now. Thank you so much. I have no words to thank you. I just like to get in Zeba here if she wants to say something and put in a vote of thanks or just thank you both for being here today with us. Zeba, you'd like to say something to Dr. Mona and Shraddha?
Thank you so much, Shraddha ji and Dr. Mona, for joining us. And I want to add one thing. When I shifted to Ahmedabad 9 years ago, the only name I know was Dr. Mona Patel. And just reaching here, and after 10 days, my son, he fell sick very badly. And I was crying on the phone, and Mona Dishi told ki, Zeba, main clinic chhod ke aa rahi hu tumhare paas. Or doctor ke paas tum ruko, I am just coming, and if you need anyone, even at 3 o'clock at night, I am there. And till today, she and her husband, Dr. Tejas Patel, they have proved it. Ke whenever I need any help, any kind of help, they are there for me. And you won't believe, I for the last 9 years, I am celebrating Eid with them. They miss my sheer khurma this time because of the COVID. I celebrate my son's birthday with them. So there are a bond between a parent and a professional.
For my year also.
Pakka, it was COVID chale jaye.
My house is not far from Deva's, from Mona's house. Just 2 minutes, sir.
We generally celebrate at Sparsh. So you have to come there.
So thank you so much, Zeba. Thank you so much, Dr. Mona. Thank you so much, Shraddha. I'm glad that we are ending, you know, this session on a high note, you know, when everybody is smiling. We all have our challenges and we are laughing. So I think that is the best thing about these sessions. They are a therapy to us also.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Right.
And these two ladies, they
thank
are
you so much.
Given a freedom
thank
to
our audience.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. And thank you to the audience also for joining and putting in questions, because maybe we miss out on a lot of things, pointers. So they remind us what needs to be asked from the panelists.
Good. Thank you so much for joining.
Thank you to all the audience, and thank you, Manoj, for giving us this opportunity. And we hope to see them back on another session when Zeba is fit and fine. Thank you so much.
Sure.
Thank you. Thank you, Manu, for inviting us. Thank you.
Thank you so much.